Gelukkig maakte de VPRO toen opname en daarvan hoor je nu Blue Garden.
We'll be right back. as much as everyone tends to think. You know, we get, like, we do hear that a lot. And we haven't been sitting around for 2 years listening to Cream albums. The Cream comparison probably do a lot to just the having a vocal range and a sound of a voice like Jack Bruce, says everybody. And being the first album, they have nothing else to compare it to. So I guess as far as the critics' world is concerned, they'll just have to hear more before they can realize what kind of style I hold for my own.
Anything that you ever listen to, anything that you ever hear, is going to surface somewhere, you know, somehow along the line. Obviously, you have to have sources that you learn from and that you can compare your own work to. But really, lately, I've been listening to, like, old stuff. Little Richard and Chuck Berry, Hank Williams.
I listen to Morrissey a lot and the Smiths, old Smith stuff. I think Morrissey is my favorite singer because he's very brave. He's a great lyricist, hysterically funny, and a great singer. We have a mutual friend who played him what was originally intended to be a five-song EP that we made over 3 years ago. And Rick liked it. And so we didn't put out an EP. We got a record deal instead.
The band was a lot like spookier sounding, effect-wise anyways, you know, a little echoey, more cathedral-oriented kind of sound. And he kind of like washed that out of our systems and put us into like the AC/DC kind of production mold almost, which was kind of tough to deal with at times, because some of the songs really relied on those types of enhancements.
It's that he wanted to show everybody just how ugly we were. You know, it's almost if you were walking down the street on a foggy night and you heard person singing in the fog, but you couldn't see them, that singing would take on a characteristic because of the surroundings, because of the fog. But if that same person was standing in front of you on a street corner on a sunny day, you might just say, oh, well, just another nut singing on the street corner. So the kind of blur that we used on our self-produced tapes, because of when you're making tapes in your basement, in order to give a chill up someone's spine, we became masters at making spooky sounding hard rock. And Rick saw good songwriting ability that didn't need the fog anymore, and he put us all up front. And I'm glad it's out there like that.
Ruben.
No, I don't think that's true. I mean, he's a groundbreaker.
He's like a classic producer in a sense that he strikes me as always looking for songs that are going to like be around for a long time. You know, and sometimes people misinterpret that as being retro, which is happening to us, I think, to a certain extent. But you know, it's the type of thing where, you know, when you put Purple Haze on, you know what's in the grooves there. You know, and you can hear it for years and years and years and over again, and it still sounds great. And I think that's kind of the key to what he's up to.
Een tijdloos geluid, daar gaat het Ruben dus om. Het lijkt erop dat de masters zijn kunstjes goed hebben geleerd. Luister maar naar The Eyes of Texas en The Candy Song.
The Eyes of Texas are upon you. The Eyes of Texas upon you. The Eyes of Texas are upon you. Now here come the
Mr. Marciality.
Well, I'm very much a fan of natural sounds and natural instrumentation. I think a great deal with what's wrong with records today is people's, because technology has come such a long way that people forget about emotion, and we get a lot of very cold sounding, antiseptic, perfect sounding records. And it's not a perfect world, and music's not a perfect thing, and I don't think it's supposed to sound as perfect as that. I think the problem that technology imposes is a lot of engineers that I've worked with in the past, every time a new piece of outboard equipment or a sound processor, let's call it, comes along, they're very anxious to use that on the next record they make because that's the new sound, and they use it on their next record, and I think it gives everything a very dated sound in terms of, my records may sound like old-fashioned, but I think they'll sound old-fashioned in a warm way and will sound old-fashioned in a good way in 10 years, as opposed to records that sound very 1989 and in 1992 sound like disco records sound today.
Met Rick Rubin, Back to Basics. Een kwestie van overleven om in 1992 nog net zo fris en ongedateerd te klinken als anno nu. Luister tot slot nog een keer naar The Masters of Reality met Kill the King.
Oh,
Kill the King. Als het King Ruben is, zou ik er toch nog maar een paar nachtjes over slapen als ik een master of reality was. Maar zo reëel zijn ze zelf ook wel, zo kon je vernemen bij monden van Chris Goss en Tim Harrington. En bij monden van producer en ontdekker van de Masters of Reality, Rick Rubin.